Joining us now for his take on the markets, Edmund Lee of Caylum Trading Institute. Hi, Edmund. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year, Mimi.
Okay, so we're back to the 7,000 level, basically range trading. How do you make money in a market like this? I mean, is it in the second or third liners? Because that's where the moves, the big moves are happening, powered by retail investors and a lot of speculation. The small guys have been moving the chips.
I think if you look at this from a global perspective, mm-hmm. it's not just happening in the Philippines, right? You're seeing huge retail participation happen, not just, I mean, it's everywhere in the world. Nonetheless, we've seen a lot of fake moves also that's happened because of retail. So how we always approach it is that things will always correct back to the mean, right? We think this is a great opportunity, actually, what we're seeing here today. Even though some of the big caps and the mid caps that we like have actually been stalling and have actually been consolidating. We think this, as the economy recovers and the economy comes back, like what we're seeing outside, most of these blue chips would also benefit.
Mm-hmm. So you're betting more on blue chips rather than the speculative names?
Yeah, definitely. We're always looking at high growth prospects.
Mm-hmm.
So the companies that are growing at more than double digit, we're always keeping an open eyes there. And we think that most investors and traders should also focus there.
Mm-hmm. Edmund, what's the sense that you're getting? Is there so much liquidity sloshing around? I mean, too much cash chasing too few assets at this point. What's the risk appetite of the Filipino investor?
No questions asked. You're looking at interest rates all over the world being close to zero. I mean, it's recovered, like in the US, the 10-year has already recovered to 1.4, 1.5%. But nonetheless, you'll probably see this note also from all central banks, including in the BSP, that interest rates will likely remain low in the next few years. And so because of that, even bonds are trading at very low rates. So there really is, I mean, they always say there's no alternative asset class, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we also believe that same case. If you're going to play this economic recovery, you should focus on equities, in my opinion, as well.
Okay, so let's go over some interesting corporate stories that we have from late last week to this morning. Converge ICT saying that it's premature to talk about possible partnerships with Elon Musk's SpaceX. There have been reports they're going to be partnering to bring high-speed broadband to the Philippines. What do you make of this?
I think it's still very early to make that to make those kinds of statements and make that calls and for the market to price that in. I think it's way too early for that. But nonetheless, I still very much like Converge. I think they're one of the very few companies still able to grow at 50-60% in the next 2 to 3 years in a very under-penetrated market. And we think the home broadband, including Converge, should do well over time.
Okay, speaking of pricing that news in, it's actually popping. Converge ICT shares right now up by 9% to 19 pesos and 26 centavos a piece. You know, I remember after IPO, immediately after IPO, the share price fell and everybody was wondering, oh my God, am I trapped? Because the share price was staying below the IPO price and now they've beat that 1680 and are on their way up. Okay, speaking of Dennis Oi, here's another story from the other Dennis Oi. From Davao, reportedly open to selling Phoenix Petroleum. That fuel retail business had a total debt as of Q3 last year at $49.2 billion. More than half was due immediately. Net loss as of the third quarter of last year was at 75 million pesos. Quick comment.
Dennis Oi already downplayed this with his disclosure this morning.
Mm-hmm.
If he's able to sell and if he does sell, I think it should be good for both subsidiaries, both for Phoenix and the holding company, Udena. If they provide enough financial flexibility, because it's not just in the oil business that they've been focused on. It's also in everything, including their third telco participation with Dito Telecom.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Yeah, so I do think that if they're able to provide any financial flexibility by this sale, I think it should be good for both companies.
Okay. So you don't see, you know, the fuel retail part of his business as a crown jewel?
Think of it this way. Most of what you're seeing today is just a movement into where you think there's bigger business opportunity, right?
Mm-hmm.
And if you look at it from this perspective, the third telco would probably be a more attractive asset than the Phoenix Petroleum.
Okay, just a note, under Phoenix Petroleum is also their Family Mart business, which they bought a few years back. How about this news? From the Ayala Group, UPC and AC Renewables, Australia reaches financial close for a stage of a New England solar farm. The Ayala Group obviously going big in the renewables energy space. Is this attractive to you?
I think it's not just going big, not just from the renewable space in the Philippines, but this is a global expansion, what you're seeing.
Most of this
is already priced in, I believe. Their target of having 2,000 megawatts by end 2022 and then 5,000 megawatts by 2025. This just proves that they're on track to meet that expectations. We're excited for AC Energy and what they're able to do. So, but we do believe that the share price, share rights offering that will happen soon will probably be an overhang towards share price.
Okay.
Nonetheless, we still like the business.
Okay. How about this one? Trans-Pacific Broadband Group gets another 25-year franchise from Congress. You know, this is one of those smaller names that have been making a lot of noise.
Yeah, I think what you're seeing for most small caps is just to be extra careful for both investors and traders alike. Most of these are still very early, premature, I don't see how most of the revenues will come in soon, but I mean, just buyers beware on this one.
Okay. Foreign news now. Elon Musk has launched a $100 million carbon capture competition. Let's talk about the bigger theme of ESG investing. Investing in companies that value and put a premium on the environment, social, and governance. Are we there yet? Are Philippine investors there yet?
I think you have to make that assumption, though. We might not be there yet, but I think we have to make that assumption. If you look at foreign investors and institutions, and you look at all the companies that they've been participating in, clean energy in the US, solar, EV, these are the same trends you'll probably also see in the Philippines. And as foreign institutions, most likely they're most likely going to be participating in these themes. So what you'll see is that most of these companies that are in that space will probably get a higher premium than the ones that are not compliant on that end.
Okay. Edmund, we've come to the most exciting part of the conversation, your blind item. Talk to us about a stock that you're monitoring closely. Don't tell us, just describe. So what is this stock that you like?
I like this company. It's growing at 50-60% per year for the next 3 years. They're in a very underpenetrated market. Last I checked, fixed broadband was under 20%, and in terms of the fiber, less than 8% of all households are in fiber. And if you compare this to the entire Southeast Asian region, we've been lagging behind on that category. So we think that the market is big enough for right now all three participants, the three big participants, we think it's big enough for all three to participate in and for all of them to thrive. They might be expensive. They're actually more than double the valuation of its peers. But nonetheless, we think the growth rate is justified. And in a market where interest rates are very low, we think the fastest growing companies will be given, there's a reason why they'll be given their higher premiums today.
Okay, just one quick question. How much upside are you seeing from the share price? It's now at $17.70.
We look at this from a longer term perspective. Maybe in the short term, we'll probably see like a 10-15% upside. But if when we look at it from a 3-4 years perspective, we think this can go up another 50-60%.
Oh, wow. Okay. We're just going to have to guess which stock you were talking about, Edmund. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. Have a great week ahead.
Thank you. Have a good day.